Hello and welcome to the Glastonbury Recording Podcast with Ian and Jem. Yeah, this week is back to normal, back to the two of us. We'll be talking about what Jem got up to while he was away. Also chatting of gigs that came up last weekend and what's on this weekend and what we have queued for. Yeah, I know. Anyway, let's kick off the show with a track by The Big Wow, and this is I Came Alone. Okay, yeah, welcome to the Glastonbury Recording Podcast with Ian and Jem. Yeah, Jem's back. How you doing, mate?
Yeah, good. Good to be back. I was worried I might be a substitute. You know, you might have pulled me off extra time because you don't think I'm any good at taking penalties. But no, great to be back. Hope you're all okay, everybody. Nice to be joining you again on Glastonbury Calling. Yeah. So what have you been up to? We haven't spoken for ages.
We've got to say well done to the England ladies first, yes, reaching the final. That's awesome. We're recording this on Wednesday afternoon stroke early evening, and getting over that.
I know the women deserve huge praise, but I had a part to play in this.
Let's hear this.
So the part to play on this is that I, like you, love sport, and I've been watching and following the Women's World Cup wherever we are. But I do have a part to play. I mean, we've got to big up the actual team. But actually, do you know that two of the three goals today, when this is being recorded, were scored the moment I walked outside of the living room where the television is to go upstairs, go to the loo or whatever, check my work emails and things like that. Two of the goals were scored because I left the room. So that's why they won.
So basically on Sunday,
yeah,
during the match, you've got to drink loads of tea or beer or one or the other, something that'll make you go to the loo loads.
Exactly.
And you then know, we'll be 6-0 up.
Yeah, because I am a valuable team member, even though I'm not playing. And tea is deliberately the pun there, if I'm drinking it. Yeah, yeah. Really excited. Really happy.
Yeah, good. You were saying, what have I been up to? Oh, well, I've been up to a few things. I did a podcast last week with Joe Atkinson.
Yeah.
I recorded one, which was good fun. I recorded one the week beforehand. I listened to it and I just thought, oh, it's really just awful. So I just didn't put it out. I was just like, I can't put that out. It's not good enough.
Oh, well, hang on a sec. You know what we should do in the festive period? We should have the best of highlights of Glastonbury Calling. But yeah, rather than being the best of, it could be the worst of. So we could find moments where one of us has actually not been on form. We've either made mistakes or talking rubbish like Barbie or whatever the other thing was. We cut that film. And we just have a kind of either a bleepers or a best of or the worst of. The worst of Glastonbury Calling. And worst could be the new best.
Oh, yeah, I don't think so. I think
we're going to work on him, everyone. We're going to get a bit of this. You know, it's like the Beatles, isn't it? With these hidden recordings. One day, that Glastonbury Calling podcast in about 60 years' time is going to be unearthed by someone from the Liversidge family, where they say, "Oh, we found a hidden thing." So when Glastonbury Calling podcast is sort of everyone's trading on the sort of physical format of the show, they'll find one hidden, unreleased episode.
We've probably recorded stuff, but yeah, probably not that great.
anyway, we better
talk about what I got up to last week. Yeah, I went and saw Jess Hellard actually.
Oh, great! At the Avalon in Glastonbury Club. Yeah,
yeah,
he's great, isn't he?
Which was good fun. Which was it used to be the old Conservative Club, and he took great fun in absolutely milking the most of the fact that it used to be, obviously it's not now, but it used to be the Conservative Club in many years ago. And of course, he's quite a big socialist. And bear in mind, he played down for Simon Stewart at the Tollpuddle Club down in Tollpuddle, which is totally the other way, the week beforehand. So to come and play in an old Conservative Club was quite good fun.
Do you remember? So, yeah, I was aware of it. Couldn't go to it because just been too busy, just too tired, really. But do you remember the time when he played? Because he loves playing in Glastonbury.
Yeah.
He's a big Glastonbury town fan. And the year before, last year, I think it was in the autumn, I went and did an interview with Jez. I hadn't seen him from ages. It was the first time post-COVID. And I was talking to this guy, and then Jez came out and saying, "That's not me you're interviewing. You're interviewing my brother." Do you remember me telling you that story?
Yeah, I do.
So I'm really scared to interview him or even say hello in case I've got the wrong person, because his brother, they're kind of almost like identical twins.
Yeah.
But tell me, was at that concert, was the cool dude on the double bass there?
Oh, yeah, he was. Yeah,
he was really good, isn't he?
He was really good. Yeah.
He's one of my favourite bassists. He's amazing.
Yeah, it was good fun. And similar, like Beans on Toast, but his style's totally different.
Yeah,
he got more and more drunk as the evening went on, Jess Hellard.
Yeah,
his stories got more and more more and more lengthy as he went along. But it was good fun. You could tell he's quite an intelligent bloke.
I love the man, and I love his bassist, and I was sort of really disappointed to have missed him. Because he also does some gigs over in Preston as well that he's a fan of. So he's doing like a mini tour. I'm so pleased you went to see him. I'm so pleased you like him because I'm a fan. And his kind of kindred is Rory McLeod, who I caught up with at WOMAD. And
Yeah.
they're both very similar in how they play and the music. And sounds amazing. Yeah, good for you.
Yeah, good stuff. Good stuff. You get up to anything at the weekend then? We'll talk about WOMAD and all the stuff in the next bit, but
Yeah, no, we got back from Italy really late. I can't even remember when we got back. It was a Thursday night. It
yeah.
was about 1 o'clock in the morning on that Friday where you were going. That's why we didn't go to Jez, and we were absolutely tired as anything.
Yeah.
And slightly under the weather, actually. Sort of, I've just lost a lot of energy. So it was kind of when we got back last weekend, was just kind of that weekend was just kind of resting up a little bit. So I didn't re haven't really done a lot really. So yeah, and today is probably the first day I feel kind of almost normal.
Almost normal. What was the weather like in Italy then? Were you still in the heat wave or are they over
Yeah,
that?
no, there was one big rainy day where we were about to eat outside on a terrace and it was hot. It was hot, which I like. And it was kind of very, very strange weather. I've been noticing on Normal from Glastonbury some incredible rainbows over the Tour and really strange meteorological sort of experiences that photograph really well. And there was a moment in Italy where the whole sky sound looked like something out of a Tim Burton movie. It was grey and it was
Yeah.
black, and there were funnel clouds, and the wind was sort of building up. You could see something was about to happen, and all of a sudden, this whole wind went down this valley, and then there were like ice balls, hailstones coming down
No
the
stones,
size of
yeah.
golf balls. It was just a massive pouring down with rain. Really, really heavy. It rained right the way through the night. That was the only day. And then the next morning it just cleared. It went, but it was really heavy rain. But the rest of the week was really hot and just really lovely, swimming in the sea. I do need some therapy. I need some help and support because normally I'm talking to you about coconut ice cream. And on this occasion, there was no coconut ice cream in Italy to be had anywhere.
Oh, that's really sad. On holiday and no coconut ice cream.
I know. So I did go for the pistachio, which is always very good. And of course, it's really cheap because it's the staple diet, isn't it? Pizzas and ice cream.
Yeah. Do Ben and Jerry's do a coconut ice cream?
They do a cookie ice cream, I seem to remember.
Okay, they don't do a coconut.
Yeah,
Yeah.
no.
I mean, that was one good thing at the weekend when we went out and had a pint. The co-op, especially if you remember, it's a
Yeah.
pound more if you're not a member. They're doing two pizzas. I sound like I'm doing an advert now, but
Yeah.
they're doing two pizzas and a tub of Ben and Jerry's ice cream for a fiver.
I know that's why I know about the cookie ice cream, because that
Yeah.
cookie ice cream was bought from the same supermarket. Excellent stuff. So yeah. Now today I've been doing stuff with youth groups in Yeovil, and we were talking about food and healthy food, and we were talking about pizzas. And then we created a debate, and I want to share this with you, okay? Okay, and
Yeah,
it's
go.
depending on what side, and then each young person was given 15 seconds to talk about for or against. So you ready to start the challenge?
So go on then, yep.
Okay, pizzas. Okay,
Yeah.
are you for pineapple on a pizza or against?
I used to have it now and again, yeah, so I would go, yeah, that's all right, yeah.
You see, pineapple is a fruit. Would you put strawberries on a pizza?
No.
Would you put bananas on a pizza?
Oh, I don't know actually.
So
Bananas, but
that's my
I mean
case.
this is without cheese. You might put do a piece of bread with bananas and Nutella like you would make a sandwich.
You put that in a pancake. Now this is we're going off
Yeah.
piece, which is what we always do. That's what
Yeah.
Glastonbury Calling is good for, because I'm here. No, you can't have a pineapple on a pizza. But I was outvoted today with the youth group. They love the pineapple on a
Why
pizza.
can't you have pineapple on a pizza?
It's sweet. You want savory on a pizza. Anyway, that was my
So
15
it's not
seconds.
because it's a fruit then.
It is because it's a fruit.
Well, what's the main ingredient of pizza?
Dough.
And
A deer? A
what
female
goes on
deer.
top? What's the red stuff made out of?
It's not blood, I can tell you that.
Yeah, tomatoes. And what's tomato?
Yeah, but it's not a pineapple, so it's
What is
fine.
tomato?
Anything but.
Tomato is a fruit.
It
So
is
putting
a fruit.
pineapple on,
Yeah.
you're putting another fruit on. You're just adding to the fruit basis, aren't you?
You are, but it doesn't feel right. I'm telling you, it does not feel right. Anyway, I was outnumbered by the young people, and I lost this argument, and I feel I'm losing it to you. So I think it is time to move on. If I can be the judge on this, I think you win, I lose, but it still doesn't feel right, is all I'm going to say.
Okay, right, let's play a bit of Cosmic Ninja. They've just released a video for this track, so this is why we're playing it again. This is Phil.
You're a fraud and a fake in the class like a snake. Running late, not a chase, and you need to know your place. The shame and the aches you did not anticipate. The sick of feeling you fucked it, so you aggravate. One day you loosen the reins up, then I fear me. Now we're letting the chains off, so we're free. Pulling down the statues, throw them in the sea. That's how we do it in Bristol, we got unique. Let
their hopes and shock themselves to seize the power. We wear price tags and sell ourselves hour by hour. And show themselves to seize the power. We wear price tags and sell ourselves hour by hour. Seize the power. Seize the power. Say what? Seize the power. We wear price tags and sell ourselves hour by hour. Seize the power. Seize the power. Say what? Seize the power. We wear price tags and sell ourselves hour by hour.
You're a number caught up and made trapped inside these walls, locked behind bars cage. More than a number outside these walls, not feeling the pressure, not sure if I'll cave. I've got a switch in my eye, but I think you'll find it's time you had the lobotomy. What will be arranged, it won't go to waste. We'll pray I'll spare, give you a taste.
Let their falsehoods and show themselves to seize the power. We wear price tags and sell ourselves hour by hour. Take their falsehoods and show themselves to seize the power. We wear price tags and sell ourselves hour by hour. Seize the power. Seize the power. Say what? Seize the power. We wear price tags and sell ourselves hour by hour. Seize the power. Seize the power. Say what?
that's Web and When the Darkness Falls. So in these couple of weeks you were off, what I'd like to talk about was your time at WOMAD.
Yeah, yeah.
How did that go?
It was amazing. Really, really good. Great to catch up with loads of people that, you know, if you like your festivals, you know, I'm sure that you'll probably be catching up and talking about Beautiful Days later. It's a really good place to meet people again. It's really, really friendly. There's music from all over the world. And have you come across the Dutty's Moonshine Band?
No.
Okay, so I'm just putting it out there. If you're listening, guys, pleasure to chat and catch up with you. Would love you if I could persuade Ian to get you at Glastonbury Calling, because they're great. Bristol band, they're really knocking it out of the park. 10-piece band, do a bit of ska, a bit of hip hop. They are so good. And so, yeah, Bristol band, and they just kind of, on the first night they played, and they were just absolutely amazing.
How many of them were there?
Yeah, that we would probably need the pyramid stage to fit them on. Could the pyramid stage be a venue for Glastonbury Calling?
I know with you. I mean, when you go, oh, this is a really good band, these are brilliant. That's my first question. How many of them are you? Just like, there's normally about 15.
Look, it's less than 15. It's slightly more than 8.
Well, my question would be, is it rugby team, football team, or basketball team?
I am going. It's not. Well, I could say it's a football team and then pretend it's 5-a-side and just pretend two teams turn up at the same time. So really, really good. I bumped into a great musical friend of mine, a Batch Gay from Bristol, who sort of plays like Senegalese music and do that on the World Beat show that I do, and he was great, and he would be brilliant as well. So, yeah, there's only 20 in his group. So that would be good. And it was just really, I didn't see a lot of music, but what I loved about it was just talking to people, talking to the crowds, and what WOMAD's all about. And what it is about for people is it's a diverse festival where everybody is at one and celebrating culture from all over the world. And they even had, we saw a bit of the cinematic orchestra. So they have like Soul to Soul were there as well. And yet the highlight for me was talking to the sound engineer at a workshop stage where they were just about to do Justin Adams as playing guitar. He's from a West Country, from Bath. Yeah. And he was the lead guitarist with the Robert Plant Space Shifters band.
Wow.
Absolutely amazing. And it was really nice talking. You know, we always have some, thanks to you, great sound engineers at Glastonbury Calling, you know, like, you know, Doug and all the guys that, you know, you've had Sophie before as well. But this guy called Kit, he's a Bristol sound engineer, and he was just totally in his element, coming from an indie background, but really enjoying mixing some sort of groups from around the world. Really, really lovely atmosphere. I was doing my little bit for World Peace, interviewed an Israeli musician and a Palestinian group. So that was really interesting as well. So loved it. And yet on the Sunday, it then started to rain and it turned a little bit into woe mud. And the last few acts that I really wanted to see was on the open air stage. And you know what? Shame my age here. We came home in the afternoon on the Sunday, so we missed the last few gigs because of the rains, which is a shame.
No. Well, understandable. But, you know, it sounds like you discovered lots of new acts anyway and had a good time.
Yeah, and also a group, I think I'm going to try and get you into them, that from London called Comet's Coming.
Jazz.
We went to see them. They were absolutely incredible. Yeah. Really, really good. So it's not just world or global beats.
I saw them at Beautiful Days, actually.
Yeah. And I'll tell you what we're saying. So we were camping camper van, and we're just resting up. And we had a really lovely next door neighbour who was doing some stuff at the festival. And I went round. We sort of got to know each other. I was talking to her, and then there's this guy with a guitar, and I said, I think I know you, you know. And it was Rory McLeod was next to us in our camper van playing his guitar with his harmonica, just like jazz. I forgot to mention that. Yeah, so he was next. It was just great having, you know, everyone around. So very, very friendly. Love the workshop stages, you know, people were dancing, you know, to African rhythms. And yeah, it was cool. Really nice. Thank you.
That sounds epic. All right. Let's play some more music now. This is the Ruz Guitar Band, and they've got a new track out called Casting My Spell.
All of you are the ships braving the night. sometimes you know I get scared. Hey, hey. I'm reaching for a hand, I find it's not there. Reaching for a hand to find. You are imperfectly you. It's the world you were meant for.
Keep your head above the water. Look around and celebrate all those who are there with you. We are brave ships sailing the wide waters of the unknown. And we were made for these times.
Okay, that's Brave Ships there by Ruth Blake. Good stuff there.
I just want to just say I love Brave Ships. It's a great choice. One of the best. She's just an incredible single. It's just such a beautiful song. Really catchy too. So well done for playing that.
I think she played a couple of weeks ago at a new venue in Redmore, the Bluebird Cafe. So they're putting on gigs every other week there. So they got good interesting acts going there. So keep your eye out on that.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. But while you were away, they announced the Pelton Party lineup anyway.
Yeah.
And while I was out on my post round, I saw the massive queue getting in my way, pushing me post trolley and that, all on the Saturday, everyone queuing up to get their tickets. But yeah, it reminded me of the olden days that we've mentioned this a little bit before, where you used to have to queue up for tickets and that, and sort of like, I was thinking of the sort of things that you queue up for, because like people don't tend to queue as much now, do they?
Well, the one place that I think people do queue, especially at this time of year, is getting back into our own country, immigration, when you get at airports or at ferry terminals. So there's definitely a bit of queuing going on there. Yeah. I don't know. I think queuing is actually something that I think people still do in this country.
Yeah.
And it's one of the last remaining elements of politeness, isn't it, really? Yeah, I queued for the toilets at Glastonbury Festival, the shower at Glastonbury Festival in June. And the queue for us there was about an hour. And it was the only day I was like...
To have a shower.
And it was really hot, you might remember. It was a really hot festival.
Yeah.
And I was deliberating whether to queue or not. So it wasn't a ticket for a group. And in the end, you know what I'm like. I just started talking to people around me. And there were some kids and there was their mum in front. And we just started chatting and they were sort of from, you know, our area. And we were talking about music and what we do and all that sort of stuff. And then we just realised we've been chatting away for about 45 minutes and we're now second in the queue, both of us. And it was one of the best queues I've ever done because everyone started to join in. And that's what I like to try and nurture. It's a really lovely way. You might as well be happy in a queue. So everyone was just talking to each other. That is the best queue I've ever been in. So big up the showers at Glastonbury and the family I was talking to. We had a right giggle. But I remember queuing for also, and this would test my age a bit, in the 80s where the Skybus took off. And for the first time ever, it became affordable to fly across the Atlantic to New York. And I would have been about 22, 23. I had no money. I just started my work. And I queued up outside Victoria train station to get on Laker Airways. And before it became quite famous,
yeah,
tickets were really cheap. And there was no advance booking. There was no online booking, obviously, in those days. And just going exactly as you're saying, we ended up in a queue. But you know what? Because it was so novel... Similar, everyone is all young people with backpacks and stuff like that. We were queuing to get our tickets. And again, I just remember it being such a buzz and the excitement of going on a Laker Airways to get over to New York, which was just out of our pockets in those days. So that is another really nice queuing experience. What was yours?
Oh, mine. I remember queuing up years ago for to watch when Swindon played Arsenal in the League Cup. And we went up and we got down there and we queued up for probably about 6 or 7 hours. We got down there really early to get tickets. This is a big deal when they played Arsenal back in the sort of like late 70s. And Swindon were down in fourth division then and Arsenal were flying in the top division with players like Liam Brady and so to go and see them playing down Swindon, and it was well worth it because Swindon knocked them out after extra time 4-3. And that whole season it was a lot of queuing because they ended up playing Spurs in the FA Cup and drew at home in the replay, played Wolves in the semi-final, so lots of queuing up there. So, yeah, that was a big year for queuing. Going up and queuing for Glastonbury tickets up at Virgin Megastores in Bristol. You go up and just join a little queue. It wasn't too bad, really. Only about half an hour and you got your ticket. Go to Glastonbury. That was in the days when Glastonbury never used to sell out.
You know what? there's different kinds of queuing. The whole idea of queuing has changed. So let's sort of move this in a sort of slightly lateral way, which I'm prone to do. So what would you prefer? No, not pineapple. We're not talking about pineapple now. We've moved it on. We're talking about queuing. What would you prefer, to be in that kind of queue, in a physical queue or a digital queue? Because you know what? My son was in a digital queue, as a lot of people want to see well-known groups are, to get tickets online. So you're waiting to get your browser and you're waiting to get yourself in the queue when, like, Taylor Swift tickets or Arctic Monkeys are queuing, or Glastonbury Festival. You're queuing and you're queuing and everyone's went, that's still a queue, isn't it? Well, and I would much personally prefer to be in a physical queue.
No, I'd rather be in a physical queue because I know that I've done the effort to do it. And then a few times on these digital ones, I've got to the front and then you go and the whole thing, it says you've got tickets, then all of a sudden you've lost your tickets and they've disappeared. So it doesn't work. Whereas, like, if you're in a physical queue, you get to the ticket office, you get your tickets. You know, so I'd rather go in a physical queue any day.
Yeah, I would agree, and I think it's quite stressful. If you've something you really love, that's why I like small gigs and small venues. You know, where you don't have to worry about things like that. I don't like the idea of being in a digital queue. It's a bit easier now. In, should we just say, Glastonbury South Somerset, because the Wi-Fi is generally okay. I remember when I was living over on the other side of the Mendip, towards Bristol Way, had no Wi-Fi, and being in a queue for Glastonbury Festival and just being timed out because I had such a weak Wi-Fi signal, and that's really stressful. Yeah. So give me a physical queue any day. I do not like digital queues.
Right, here's one of my ideas now.
Okay.
I hear the worry now coming on. You'll like this one.
Okay, go for it.
You know how people are doing things to support record stores.
Yeah.
So when they do their record releases and record release days in record stores, especially the massive artists who organising gigs in Wembley or whatever, they should put on sale like about 50 albums in each of these small record stores and put 50 tickets on sale. So you get an album and a ticket for whatever, say, you know, the tickets our days are, they're about 80 to 100 quid, aren't they? For, say, like you were saying with Taylor Swift, ticket. And you get like a nice physical souvenir ticket as well, something to keep hold of, not a digital barcode thing. And also alongside that, you get your album as well. You get a special release album. And then that would support record stores even better because people would go and queue at the record stores as well.
I like that idea. I know one musician that probably would really love to do it and probably already has, which is Frank Turner. He'd be well up for that.
Yeah, I think a lot of people, if someone put it to Taylor Swift, someone put it to Coldplay, some of these, they would do it. I'm sure they would. You know,
I've still got some of my gig tickets. I haven't got many left, but I've still got my Steely Dan tickets in my Steely Dan CD, even though I have Steely Dan vinyl. Have I mentioned Steely Dan too many times or not enough yet?
Yeah. You mentioned Steely Dan too many times. Let's play some music. Right, this is John G. Revelator, who's playing down King Arthur on Thursday. It's a track called Hope.
Socially distant now, we can't get too close. We're standing doors in pajamas and baggy clothes. How long it lasts, well, nobody knows. But the impossible is the everyday since all this arose. Free falling, economies are shot. We're making do and mending, getting by on what we've got. They tell us to wear masks and gloves, just nipping down the shops. And we're never gonna turn back time or restart the clock. But I see hope. Yeah, I see hope. I see hope. Yeah, I see hope. 'Cause the girl on the checkout, she now smiles and catches my eye. There's randoms in the street greeting you as you pass by. There's quiet roads, clear air and great blue empty skies. And spring birds singing in the trees to the first few butterflies. Gives me hope, that gives me hope. That gives me hope, that gives me hope. Hope that when it's over and we're clearing up the mess, hope that we'll remember how we'll cheer the NHS. Hope that the folks in charge will never now forget that blood, bone and heart and soul mean more than profit and debt. I see hope, yeah, I see hope. I see hope, yeah, I see hope. Mrs. Thatcher said, there's no such thing as society, but good people volunteering and the millions of vaccines gives me hope. That gives me hope. That gives me hope. That gives me hope. Hope that we will never make the same mistakes again. We reward the bravery of the frontline women and men. Hope that we'll remember what's important to us all. Health and home and family, non-stop market rise and fall. We can all hope. We can all hope. We can all hope. We can all hope.
My heart bathed in sound and naked in the dark. All this bag of bone feels carved in stone, and you long for a clean skin. Your heart against this world too long, pissed in your own swimming pool too long. Some days you ride dark horses, some nights you howl at the moon. A hall full of cakes filed in boxes, but you never sue for a clean skin, a clean skin.
I've read you. Some days you ride dark horses, some nights you howl at the moon. A hall full of case files in boxes, but you never sue. All this bad. Carved in stone, and you pray for a clean skin, a clean skin.
Another Glastonbury-based artist there, Duncan Beatty, Clean Skin there. I haven't played that for a little while. I'm a postman.
Yeah, two lovely tracks there as well. Yeah, it's good to have them aired on the Glastonbury Calling podcast. Excellent.
Yeah, so yeah, going on about this weekend, Leathers playing at the Golden Lion, John D. Revelator, King Arthur, Songs of Life concert with Tarek and Martin Slater. At the Assembly Rooms. Those are on Thursday. On Friday, at the King Arthur, Killerton are playing, so I'll be going down to that with Ritz. And then Saturday, Chaz 23 and the Cub at the King Arthur. That's a DJ night. Dogs Royal are playing at the Rifleman's. And on Sunday, the Sunday Sessions, at the Railway at Mere are Charlie Miller and Sarah Griffiths, and Cameron Scott is playing the King Arthur. So there are your gigs there for this weekend. Are you up to much weekend?
I am working on Saturday at a library for a children's Windrush event. We hope we get, again, we hope we get a nice turnout. You never know in the holiday time. So that's just in the morning. Nothing planned yet, I think. We may just enjoy the garden, go on a walk. But we were talking about this, weren't we, about the possibility of going to the Railway Inn. Because I haven't been to the Railway Inn for absolutely ages. And love Sarah Griffith and also Charlie Miller.
Yeah.
And it'll be really nice to go to that. So that is the plan. And in talking about Charlie Miller, I've got myself all confused, but I just need to mention and give a big shout out. If we rewind the conversation back to WOMAD, had a nice catch up with Ursula, ZZ Birmingham's daughter from Ushti Baba. So again, another group that might be interested in playing Glastonbury Calling. So if I get this recorded out there, you know, some of these ideas, there's only, there's only about 18 in that group.
Yeah, I know. I was tapping up Jerry because that's another person I'm postman for. All these people I'm postman for. Jerry, who's in the band, yeah?
Yes. Yeah.
I was chatting. I'm her postman as well. So I'm like almost every musician's postman in Glastonbury, really.
Yeah.
So
what you should do is you should have like a post event whereby, you know, when you deliver their physical letters, they get to play at Glastonbury Calling for free.
Yeah, could do.
We'd have to enumerate them. Doesn't feel right.
No,
I'm feeling really mean now. Can we zip over that? Anyway, that's the idea. So you could put something on their envelope, like a post-it. Please play at Glastonbury Calling.
Yeah, might do. Yeah, that might be an idea. Yeah, so, yeah, I think this weekend, definitely going to the Arthur on Friday, watch Killer and play. The Saturday, we're heading over to Chipnham. So we're going to watch, I'm going to go and see Chipnham Town play for the first time since before lockdown. So it's a long, long time since I've watched them play. They're doing okay, actually, at the moment. And then Sunday, yes, hopefully Sunday sessions, but it's like the Women's World Cup final. So what if that goes into extra time and penalties? I'm a bit like, we'll just have to play it by ear. We'll just have to, hopefully England will dispatch Spain 3-0 in 90 minutes. We'll see them pick up the trophy.
The good thing about women's football is avoiding kind of some of the arrogance that goes in. You know, you don't see any kind of fisticuffs or anything like that. Yeah. It's all very calm. Lots of enthusiasm, lots of different sets of fans not calling out racist chants or whatever, just being, just decent with each other.
Well, I think that final Spain game is going to be, because Spain are quite an open side anyway.
Yeah.
I think we could see quite a few goals. Could it be like 3-2 to them or 3-2 to England?
I'm not even going to forecast it. You're getting me nervous. I think it's time to go. I'm getting really worried.
I was confident we beat the Aussies today. I was confident we beat them by a couple of goals. I just thought they would have a bit of pressure on them, which none of the teams that we played so far in knockout stages have had. But I thought they were the first team we'd be playing who were a bit more nervy about it. So, Anyway,
no, you're spooking me out. We'll do this again next week, and then we'll be able to sort of relive some moments. Who knows? I'm getting really worried now. Listen, everyone. Can you just send Ian? Can I just put him on mute a moment? We don't want to hear about what he's going to say because he'll spook it out.
Okay,
what I'm going to do? I'll leave the room. Bye, everyone.
Anyway, we'll say goodbye to everyone. Thanks for listening. We're going to finish up with one of the acts playing at Railway on Sunday. This is Breaking Loose by Charlie Miller. Thanks a lot, Jem. Nice to have you back.
Let me in, I've got to dance at 4. He said,